Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
My father was telling me one day about, you know, this dog breed that can catch fish and hunt with uncanny intelligence. And I said, you know, hey, you're making up these stories. There's no such dogs. And he says, yes, there is. It's called a Phu Quoc dog. And our hometown is very famous. They're very famous in Vietnam for having this breed. My uncle was a doctor, so patients would pay, sometimes they would pay up in, you know, food and other gifts. And so we had people from Phu Quoc that would bring over the dog. I just, at the time, I didn't know it was a, you know, Phu Quoc dog. It was just a special dog. The uniqueness of the breed is that even people in Vietnam believe that they cannot come off the island. So if they come off the island, they're gonna die. So if you're gonna bring a dog off the island, you have to bring the sand of the island with you and, you know, add it to their food, or they're going to die. My name is Jean, and I am a breeder of the Vietnamese Phu Quoc dogs. And we've been doing that for just a little bit over a year now. It started with just training a friend's dog. After training one dog, we wanted to import our own and introduce the breed into the United States. I was born in Kien-Giang province, which is the province that is where the dogs are, live, and that's where they're famous. The Phu Quoc dog breed is used primarily for hunting on the island. So hunters would use them either alone or in packs. They would be used to hunt small game, and a lot of times they will hunt on their own and then bring the game back to their owners, or they would hunt in packs. So one would chase, one would bite, one would corner, and one would retrieve. And so they will be named that too, chase, bite, corner, like bite, go, you know, go get it. And that, you know, that dog would bite. So they each know what their job is within the pack. Now, together as a pack, they can hunt big games, I mean, you know, 3-4 times their size. After the Vietnam War, there were 800 left. And there were some biologists that were really concerned about this, and they had no choice. They said, if we don't bring some of these dogs off of the island, they're going to, you know, be extinct. So, you know, it's either that or, you know, try something. And so they brought them off the islands, and from then they were able to bring the numbers up. And then the conservation effort really full speed in the 80s and the 90s and so forth. And now they've gained a new popularity because people are better off. They're wealthy now and they can think about pets instead of trying to make a living and, you know, surviving. And so people that are nationalistic are starting to look at these dogs, you know, because it's sort of like a Vietnamese pride thing. The Vietnamese Kennel Association came up with a breed standard, so they're still kind of fine-tuning it and trying to get FCI recognition. The problem is that they don't speak English, and so it's an English language barrier. So it's been a slow-going process, and we're trying to partner up with them to help them, you know, get that going. Height and weight, if you're talking from the bottom of the legs to the ears, about 25 inches. And then the weight for male, probably 45, female would be about 35. When you're looking at a Phu Quoc dog, you're looking for a couple of things. The experts would look for like the ears. The ears should be erect. The muzzle should be pointy and long and not round and short. And then you're looking for a spotted tongue. You're looking for a ridge on the back. And you're also looking for webbed feet. So these guys are swimmers and climbers. So their paws tend to be sort of not flat out, but curled in so that they can grab well. And for catching fish, of course, and swimming. There are three Ridgebacks. You have the Rhodesian Ridgebacks, which originates from Africa, and then you have the Thai Ridgeback and the Vietnamese Ridgeback. Now, there's a controversy between the Vietnamese and the Thai Ridgeback, and really nobody knows which came first. But there is notable differences. The Thai Ridgebacks are a lot stockier, they're bigger, and their hair is skin tight, it's short. Whereas with the Phu Quoc dogs, they're smaller, they're lighter, they're taller as well, and their coat's a little bit longer. The Phu Quoc dog is a very active dog. They are used to being outside. They're running, climbing. So they're not the sofa, the couch potato type of dogs. You've got to keep them active. They need to be walked at least, you know, at least twice a day. You're talking about 30-minute walks. They need to be kept mentally active also. So if they get bored, they're going to run. They're going to pick the locks. They're going to jump the fence. And they're pretty much going to make your life miserable. Dog aggression, it just depends. And again, you know, with any type of breed, it's on the owner. I have dogs that were raised from puppies, and they're well with cats, they're well with rabbits. They're well with other dogs. And then if you have a dog that you just throw in the backyard and you don't socialize, you're going to have a problem. You're going to have a problem with people, you're going to have a problem with pets, you're going to have a problem with kids. They're hard to train because they're intelligent. So, an example, there's one dog that I taught, you know, you don't jump over the fence into the neighbor's yard. And he, you know, he knew, okay, I'm not gonna jump over the fence. So what he did was he jumped onto the fence. And it's like, okay, I didn't go over, you know. So it's things like that. You teach them one thing that's a no, but they start thinking. They start strategizing. Okay, she said that this is a no. Now, how do I go around that? What's the loophole? So they're constantly thinking of how to get the better of you. So with these dogs, you got to stay on top of them and you got to show them who's boss.
And then, you know, you play with their nose too.
Nice.
Your nose and their nose.
Yeah.
And then paying them, you're teaching them to basically being, domestic dog.
Yeah.
You know, and then most people don't realize too, by flipping the dog upside down for like 10 seconds,
mm-hmm.
you're teaching them to be, when they travel around, they don't get motion sickness.
Socialization is key. They are uncannily intelligent, very active. So you got to establish the boundaries right off the bat from the time they are young. And you got to be firm. Obedience is not just, you know, like 12 classes, 6 classes, whatever, and then you're done. It's an everyday thing. Every interaction is a chance to show them, hey, this is good, or no, that's bad. And they pick it up really quickly. But it's imperative that that's done. In the beginning, when they're a puppy, you know, I would say puppy to maybe 2-3 years old, they're gonna need consistent exercise. So you're talking about probably, I would recommend, you know, at least 2 walks a day, about 30 minutes each. But, you know, if you're active and you're a runner, you know, running, you know, 2 miles, 3 miles plus a day, I think would be adequate. It's just consistency. Some people would be like, okay, well, I don't feel like walking my dog today, so I'm just gonna walk him for 10 minutes. That's not the kind of owner that would do well with this breed, because this breed is high maintenance in terms of activities, because you've got to interact with it. They want to be with you. But in terms of, say, maintenance with grooming and things like that, that's minimal. They are very adaptable. So it depends on you. I mean, if you're a good trainer, they're fine in an apartment. Okay, but the best environment for them is just a place where they can be with you, their owner, their pack leader, and a place that they can exercise. So if you're in an apartment, but you run 4 miles a day, or, you know, you hike and you're up in the mountains, you're kayaking, that's perfect. That's paradise. Versus a dog who's got 3 acres, but, you know, he's out there by himself, or somebody who's got a yard and he's only out in the yard and he does, you know, 10 minutes walks around the neighborhood. So it all depends. The main thing is activity and being with the owner. This breed is very hardy. In Vietnam, and, you know, they don't have any veterinary care, their diet is suboptimal. They live to about 12, 15 years old. So, I mean, in the United States, we don't have any that's been here that long, so it's hard to say, but obviously we have a better diet, a better vet care system. So, you know, it'll be exciting to find out, but you're looking at least 12 to 15 years. Health-wise, they are not known for any joint problems, hip dysplasia, but there is one thing that all Ridgebacks have in common, and that's the dermoid sinus. Dermoid sinus is a neural tube defect, and what a neural tube is the tube that develops in a newborn and it becomes your spinal column. So what happens is that there's a sac and it's supposed to close and cover the spinal cord. But in some puppies, the separation between the spinal sac and the skin, the surface of the skin, doesn't close. So there's a duct that goes from the outside, you know, from the outside of the skin right into the spinal system. So you can imagine if you get an infection and the infection goes into the spinal cord, it can be pretty serious. Early detection is key. So if there's a puppy that has a spinodermal sinus, it can be surgically excised and tied off. And most of the time, you know, I would say 99% of the time, they do well. And there has been research and documented cases for the Rhodesian Ridgebacks. In terms of diet, we do kibbles to make sure they get complete nutrition. And then once a week, we'll do bones, and that helps them with their teeth. And then in terms of the diet, we try to gear it towards a sensitive skin diet because it's drier here and they tend to get dermatitis and dandruff. They do not have food allergies. Obviously, in Vietnam, they eat is whatever's left over. And it's sad because a lot of times it might be just white rice or ong choy, which is, you know, like a watercress type of vegetable. After the Vietnam War, there were 800. Now in Vietnam itself, maybe I would say in the thousands, but I wouldn't go as far to say that it's double digit thousands. So we still have a lot of work to do in terms of conservation. Right now, the breed is very popular, so there's no breeding ethics in Vietnam. So you're getting a lot of crossbreeding, just as long as you get a bridge on the dog, and that's their, you know, Phu Quoc dog, which is obviously going to change the breed as we know it. So that's why I brought, you know, a pair over to the United States, just to protect and preserve the breed as we knew it growing up. This breed is just uncanny, I mean, in terms of their intelligence. And whatever I tell you, you're probably not going to appreciate unless you own one yourself. These guys are good strategists, and so they observe and they learn. They look at how you lock up their kennel, and after several days or even a couple of hours, they can figure it out. They will continue to amaze you, and they're very loyal. So that's the thing, they will protect you. This dog breed is very close to my heart because, you know, I left Vietnam at such an early age, and I kept hearing stories of this breed from my father. And I lost my father to cancer, and it was just during the time that I had taken care of him that he told me about this breed. So it's a way for me to stay connected, not only, you know, to the quote-unquote motherland, keep in touch with my roots, but also, you know, a special part of my dad. And so, you know, it reminds me of him.